Well, this is very exciting. My name is Julie Turner. I am the editor of the Bedford Citizen. I am here today with Anthony Parker, who is principal of the Weston High School and one of the four finalists in the search for a new superintendent for the Bedford Schools. Anthony, thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Well, it is definitely our pleasure. So, quick question. Can you tell our viewers a little bit about yourself, kind of a capsule version?
Yes.
Please?
Yes. Well, as you said, I'm principal of Weston High School. I've been there in Weston Public Schools for 14 years. Before that, I was in Newton Public Schools for the previous 13 years. And before my life in education, I was a journalist. I was a magazine writer in New York and Washington, D.C., and for a little bit in Boston before going off to grad school. So I live in Newton with my wife, and I have three sons who are all adults and launched, including one who is in the family business. He's a third grade teacher in Boston.
Wonderful. How outstanding. Fabulous.
Yes.
So I think what we're going to try and do is kind of, we have a lot of questions, but there is some kind of in categories.
Okay.
And so if we could talk about why did you apply? What are you particularly interested in becoming superintendent of the Bedford Schools?
Well, I think Bedford is a strong community. I'm familiar with Bedford. I'm familiar with certain aspects of the community over
How
the years.
How is that?
Well, I knew a lot of people. My wife and I were long-term members of Grace Chapel in Lexington.
Oh. Okay, and that would do.
A lot of their families and staff lived in Bedford and came through the Bedford Public Schools.
Fair enough.
Okay, and so we attend the campus in Watertown now, not in Lexington. So I've been familiar with Bedford, and I know John Sills when he was principal of the high school.
That's true,
we were in principal meetings and things like that. And so Bedford is a strong, dynamic district. It's a diverse district, all right? Particularly with its three distinct communities, in Boston, Hanscom, and Bedford itself, and the diversity of it that I like, racial and ethnically, but socioeconomically, you know, I think it's an eclectic mix, and that interests me greatly. But I think Bedford, you value excellence, okay, and I think you value innovation, and I believe you're in a place where. I believe you want the opportunity to think differently about how we educate kids.
Did you see my second question? On a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being the most, how innovative would you say you are? Can you provide us an example of your most innovative out-of-the-box idea? You saw that. You're good at reading upside down.
Well, I would say a 7 would like to approach 10. And I'll give you an example.
How do you, 7 approach 10, tell me about that.
Well, on a scale of 1 to 10.
Oh, 1 to 10, I did ask that, didn't I? Whoops.
Right, so I would say 7. So the most innovative thing I've done was help an idea become reality in Weston. It wasn't my idea, all right? The thing about innovation, and as a leader, okay, the idea doesn't have to be yours, all right? My job
Lead
is-
from behind.
My job is, that's a great idea. My job is to clear the field, help get the buy-in, and make it happen. Then it becomes our idea.
Fabulous.
Right? So that's number one. June Academy. And I'll tell you the story about June Academy. And I think it was very innovative, all right, and very simple.
That's okay. The best ideas are. Okay.
My math department head and my English department head came up to me and said, Anthony, we have an idea, right? We're always talking about, you know, stress for the kids, learning for learning's sake, not just for the grade, thinking outside of the box. Well, you know, after the seniors graduate the first Friday in June, you have these 2 weeks of school and everyone's dragging, no one wants to be there. What if we flip the script and we toss the traditional curriculum out, right? And people could take courses that really interested them, right? Mm-hmm. And so I brought the idea to my full cabinet. They liked the idea, said, how could we make that work? But, you know, we're willing to try it. superintendent, school committee were supportive. Parents were supportive. They said, we have to do this. Private schools do it all the time. Right? They have their J term or whatever it is.
Yeah.
All right. So students love the idea. When will that ever happen again where all the major stakeholders were willing to put their money where their mouth was and said, okay, we don't know how this will go, but you know what? We'll do it. And so June Academy is you can teach in areas of your certification for teachers, or you could teach something you are passionate about. Right? Students can co-teach with a teacher. This year, it'll be our fourth year, we have a student who spearheaded the introduction of American Sign Language. It's a June Academy course that she will help teach. Right? It's pass-fail. There's no homework. Right? And so
well, because nobody's doing homework in June anyhow.
Exactly. And so we have about 80 seminar courses, ranging from gardening for the apocalypse to the history of filmmaking, Italian, which we don't offer, self-defense for women. And the beauty of that is the middle school have their own version called J-Term. All right, so it's a secondary thing. And the school committee voted during the first year, you have to successfully pass 3 years of June Academy to get a Weston High School degree. And other high schools in the Metro West area are piloting or thinking about piloting it.
But what a wonderful way to leverage a less than optimal couple of weeks in the year and turn it into something that everybody's looking forward to and wanting, and have it be a graduation requirement.
And it's been successful, and we fine-tune it every year. And we get feedback, what worked, what didn't work. We have field trips. No field trips abroad. Well, we still have some on the docket, but but we'll see how that goes.
Yeah.
But local trips, shark tanks, kids have to, there's tasks they have to ride the T in Boston to do in different parts of the city.
That's a big thing for suburban kids.
Yes, yes. And we worked with the union. So if you're full-time, we know how much you should teach. Classes are 2 to 3 hours. There's morning sessions, afternoon sessions. The courses could be a week long or they could be 2 weeks. And so it's a simple thing. We pushed everything back, but APs are done. We pushed up the date for final exams, and teachers adjusted curriculum, you know?
So you got all the things done you needed to do.
But you know what? We could talk about it or we could do it.
I'm glad you did it. If I were counting that, I might put it a peg or two above a 7. That's a pretty good idea as far as I can tell.
Well, it was a wonderful effort, and that first year we gave teachers all of our professional development time was devoted to June Academy courses. So I formed a committee that had departmental representation from every department, and one of my guidance counselors is the coordinator of it. One of my science teachers schedules it, and we have parents who sit on the steering committee.
Yeah.
So we have their input. And so it was a small thing, but it works more times than not. So I think the simplicity of it was innovative, you know?
Well, and again, you're kind of leading into my next set of questions about process.
Mm-hmm.
So you clearly had process wired for that. Mm-hmm. School start time is one of the questions that came.
Mm-hmm.
What is your opinion on changing to a later school start time for Bedford High School? If you believe it is a good idea, explain how you would implement the change and how would you consider challenges and involve the parent community in that process?
Well, I can tell you what we've done because we have a later start time now.
We're
in our second
year.
We're
ready for you there.
Okay. We used to start at 7:35. So for the middle and high school, middle school's right next door to the high school. We start at 8:45 for kids. Teachers come in at 7:30, kids come in at 8:45. I mean, you can get there earlier, but classes begin 8:45 to 3:15. It was spearheaded by school committee. The superintendent was a part of it. Right?
Okay.
We had two school committee members, the chair and vice chair at the time.
Yeah.
Right. all the principals, parents. We had a K through 12, so all five principals, parents, and teachers, right, from every level.
Yeah.
All right, and we had parents who were doctors, so, you know, all the science behind it, right? And I believe there's a website that you could, parents could see all the literature, all right? So why are we doing this? And we tried it before, but what was different was that the school committee and the superintendent, what they told the community was, we think this is a good thing for kids, and this is where we want to end up. And so we spent the year building the buy-in. So it wasn't so much, what do you think about it? This is good for kids, here's the science, all right? And everybody from all the principals and the school committee sent a very clear message, we think this is good for kids. Then we formed the committee to say, okay, make the case. And they presented to various groups in Weston at the time.
So busing beyond wasn't parents.
Oh, it has to be. It has to be. Parents.
Well, it's because it makes an impact on traffic, too.
Traffic, all right, transportation, Boston students, everyone had to be at the table if this was going to work, all right? But we addressed the challenges saying this is a problem to be solved, okay? Not that we can't do it because there's too many variables and moving parts.
Right?
That makes a big difference.
Yeah, it certainly does. It certainly does. So in preparing to become the superintendent, is there one data point that struck you as positive and another that made you want to learn more about the Bedford system?
Well, we're experiencing some of the similar gaps in achievement by certain groups, African-American students and students with disabilities. Okay, so
MCAS scores,
or MCAS scores, but you know, yes, MCAS. And so, how do you want to tackle that? So that's a wondering. All right,
something. Okay.
All right, in my various interview groups, we've talked about that. We've talked about that because we were experiencing the same thing. All right, so that made me wonder. Okay, what are you folks doing? Okay, how are you thinking about approaching that? A lot of things attracted me to Bedford, some of which I looked at. I like your commitment to equity, okay, social consciousness, and balancing that, you know, with quality academics, as if they go hand in hand, right?
Mm-hmm.
Your commitment to equity and access for all students, I like that. All right, I like the questions about that, particularly in the first interview that I had. All right, that was a key theme, something that's near and dear to me. All right, equity, access,
yeah,
okay, and culture. Right.
I would like to offer an opinion, but I'm not here to do that. Mm-hmm. I am not here to do that. So based on that, the next step would be, do you have a set of core values as a district leader that you'd like to share?
Yes, and the core values that we helped implement in my school, all right? Engagement, all right? Integrity, resilience, and responsibility.
How do you teach a kid to be resilient?
I'm allowing them to fail.
How do parents get along with that?
Depends on who the parent is.
Okay.
Depends on who the parent is. I think intellectually most parents get it, but you know, no one wants to see their child struggle.
Oh.
And so, you know, there's the head and there's the heart. But not always coming in to the rescue sometimes. You know, that's the only way you learn resilience.
Top skill. So then you had spoken a little bit about MCAS, and Bedford, one of the parents or community members said, right now we have a gap in MCAS scores for the special education subset. Can you please discuss how we can work to help these students achieve at the same level as their non-disabled peers?
Mm-hmm. Well, it's going to take, we're going to have to drill down and see, okay, what are we doing and what do we have to do differently? What skills, what is the gap actually showing? How are we teaching English? How are we teaching math? How are we teaching science? And what do we have to do differently? You have to start there, right? I do not have a magic bullet because we're wrestling with that ourselves. So I do know it's going to involve programming. Maybe we have to do something different with the curriculum or how we personalize instruction for students who struggle. Do we offer extra classes to support, right, their regular math or English or science class? I think we have to be flexible with it. So I don't have a silver bullet, okay, but I do know we'd have to bring the teachers together, okay, to look at the data and say, let's break this apart. What is it showing us and what can we do differently?
Yeah. And how do you, I was thinking about my next question instead of listening carefully. Mm-hmm. What steps have you taken to just decrease the gap in Weston?
Yeah, well, what we are doing together as a district, we formed a data team. Okay, we formed a data team at the high school, all right, which involves teaching and learning, assistant superintendent for teaching and learning, and all of the department heads. And we're going through the process now of looking at data, all right, okay, and then sharing it with teachers. Okay, what to comment on it? What is the data telling us? So that question I mentioned in the previous.
Yeah.
Okay, what is it telling us? And so, based on that, what do we need to do, continue to do, or do differently?
And right. What is the ground that you're standing on? You're not, yes, just standing in the middle of a swamp. You have something, yeah, hard stuff to stand on.
Yes, we're looking at the data. So, and those are some of the most successful meetings, and we've shared some of our findings with faculty, and we'll continue to do that because to get their ideas about, let them respond, react to the data.
Well, and then does that have an implication for your budget issues? How do you translate that to budgetary concerns?
Well, you know, if we do this and we have a finding that we feel is going to help a certain cohort of our students be successful, that immediately becomes a priority.
Okay.
Budget-wise, it has to be. It has to be. All right, so that, you know, if you've identified an area where you believe you can show progress for students who are underachieving, and you believe you have a mechanism to get them there, but it's going to require funding, all right, I think our core values demand that it become a priority, budget-wise.
Well, and how do you deal with competing priorities?
Well, with
How do you put one set against the other, and
where's the greatest need? Okay, it's not easy.
Yeah.
But
okay.
What's the greatest need? And sometimes you make decisions about what's going to come first. Okay, but I would posit to you that if in fact it should always be a priority that trumps everything else, if students who are lagging behind, okay, can be successful. When is that never a priority? That's always number one, whether it's high school, middle school, elementary. All right, that's how you make that decision. All right, and sometimes, you know, sometimes priorities can, you know, or issues or budget priorities, you know, you want to make people aware. As I was explaining earlier, it's a foot in the door. We may not get it this year, but it's a foot in the door.
Patience is a virtue.
Yes.
And persistence goes right along with it.
That's right. And we want to begin talking about it.
Yeah. Okay.
This is important. All right. Because, you know, I had the high school principal asked me, you have four different principals and they all have priorities. Okay. Well, what is the district priorities? All right. Who is going to be helped the most, the soonest, the quickest? Okay. And where is there the greatest need?
And then your strategies for bringing everybody together to create a leadership team?
Mm-hmm. Well, first, what is the leadership team that is here? You know, and do we need to add to it or, you know, to collaborate? And so we all talk about our priorities, all right? And then we, you know, have a process where we winnow it down to say, okay, what are the most important things that we need at this time?
Yeah. One of the things that has been, if not top of mind, certainly upper third, in Bedford for the past couple of years is the Challenge Success Program. Do you have any experience with that in Weston?
I do. In fact, last spring we went to Stanford with Denise Pope and crew. There was about six of us, and we went to Stanford. And one of the great things that they advocated for, and I was quite proud of this actually, one of the things they said was, you know, re-examine homework policies to help, you know, you don't have to have a lot of homework to be rigorous. Well, we'd already implemented no homework weekends at the high school.
Every weekend? No.
No.
Just asking for a friend.
No, once a quarter, no homework weekends, and over breaks, you know, let the kids have a break, winter break, February break, April break. So we'd already begun that process. They advocated for late start time. Well,
you're on that track too.
We implemented it. They talked about advisories. We implemented advisories.
You know, what is an advisory?
An advisory is where a person, an adult in the building, has a group of kids that they mentor or help mentor during their 4 years in high school. So, for instance, I have an advisory.
Okay, would that be kind of like a homeroom in olden days?
We used to have homeroom, and now under the new schedule, we don't have homework. And
so a homeroom.
Homeroom, yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Homeroom.
All right.
We used to have homeroom.
Okay.
But when we went to the late start, we did away with homeroom.
Yeah. Okay.
And so now we have advisories, and the goal was to mix kids up with people they wouldn't necessarily associate with, and to have another adult in the building who doesn't necessarily grade you or write your college recommendation, but who knows you. Okay. Who knows you? All right. And you can talk about anything under the sun, can be informal, it can be formal. Excuse me. And they're groups of 12 to 13, you know.
Yeah.
And so these are a lot of the things that Challenge Success talked about that we've already implemented, you know, so we were quite proud of that. And so complementing the data team, there's a social emotional learning team. Okay, that's also department heads and the central office to look at, okay, we've done some of the big things of Challenge Success. What are some of those smaller little things that we could do, all right, where we challenge people to say, what does it mean to be a successful student in 2020?
Well, and what about kids who are just doing school, that are, they're there, but they're in body and not so much in mind?
Well, you know, that's a tougher nut to crack, you know, and I think innovation and doing things differently, because Bedford, I'm going to make an assumption here, if you're like Weston or like Newton or like most high-end schools, all right, we have a lot of students who know how to do school. They don't like it. And so that engagement piece, all right, and sometimes I think the structure of school inhibits kids' love of learning. My wife said that for years, you know, until I became a principal, I didn't really get it, but I could see it. You know, where some kids, the actual structure of traditional school inhibits their level of engagement, right? They don't enjoy it. So something, programs like a June Academy, okay, are opportunities to give students voice.
Or maybe even just a good person as an advisor.
Or a person as an advisor who they can connect to, who have a particular passion or interest, okay? Or opportunities within the school where they could think differently or more creatively, right? As I've said to several folks here, you know, kids want to be in a place, and teachers too, the adults, when you want to be in an environment where you can be creative. What if? What if?
What if?
You know?
Yeah.
You know, what if you thought of, did this way? That's how June Academy started, okay? And good leadership allows people to be able to ask the question and ideally actually have a chance of putting it into effect, right?
A continuum.
Yeah. I think a strong district and strong leadership can take a good idea, you know, a what if idea, what if, right? and help people get buy-in so that in a short period of time, you can go from idea to reality.
That maybe ought to be the book you ought to be thinking about writing. I'm just again, asking for a friend. The next question in our little menu here is about the pressures and stresses on students, and that has been part of challenge success here mm-hmm. in Bedford, and certainly the emotional component and the social emotional component is important in many ways. Thoughts?
Yes, I think that's a nationwide phenomenon. And there's lots of reasons for that. Life is different and more busy now for kids. No matter what we think about that, the reality is that's how it is, all right, for these kids. And it goes back to engagement. How can we engage them? How can we build up their capacity to be resilient? All right, you're going to struggle. School is hard, all right?
But so is life.
So is life. And what we as adults have to understand, and I say this to my parents all the time, and it's about high school primarily, but it's about you know, as you're getting older, you know, school is not just an intellectual exercise, all right? Think about it. While we want to promote rigorous academics, and we should, right? What else are kids thinking about, particularly as they transition into high school, right? Things count, grades, driver's license, first boyfriend, first girlfriend, first major breakup.
Uh-oh.
Okay, your friends change.
Yeah.
Right? All that's happening at the same time. That is stressful. All right? And schools, because as kids get older and they have more interest, as they're trying to be successful, they're going to spend more time in school than they will at home. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And so if we're going to personalize education, if we want to meet students where they are, then we have to have the capacity, the personnel, and the structures in place to help mitigate the anxiety, help them negotiate, you know, struggles.
Yeah.
Right? And that's programs. That's personnel, as simple as a youth counselor whose sole job is to just support, you know, kids and parents as they struggle through a difficult time. Right, it's looking at our policies. What are we requiring kids to do? Do we have to continue to do it that way?
And how does all that then move down to kids to a special ed program?
Well, this would impact students on an IEP as well, especially if you have an inclusion model and you want to, you want them to be able to access everything that everyone else can access. All right, and so, you know, whatever a student's IEP requires, this is what we are obligated to do.
Mm-hmm.
All right, and sometimes if that means that we have to do something different than a general education student, then that's what we do. If it means that that student can experience learning and excellence to his or her utmost ability. All right, I haven't always thought that way, but I do now.
What changed your mind?
Dealing with kids.
Oh, okay.
Dealing with kids and seeing the issues that they bring.
Yeah.
Okay, wrestling with adults about how best to serve them, you know. And as I remarked to a group earlier, an excellent school, an excellent district is one where kids have what they need to learn, all right? And that could be different for different kinds of learners.
I think he's reading my list. Because the next question is about the number of different home languages mm-hmm. that are in Bedford. I think it's mm-hmm. up over 50 languages that are spoken at home. Mm-hmm. And some kids come in as English language learners mm-hmm. when they don't have very much English. I mean, they are learning English yes. as well as everything else.
Mm-hmm.
Does Weston have a similar piece, or would that be new for you?
EL? No. No, English language learners. We don't have as many languages. I believe I don't have the exact number, but we have a variety of languages where English is a problem, you know, and so we make every effort to translate, okay, missives home, you know, letters yeah. or notices home, to meet those needs. We have the EL program just moved from the middle school to the high school, all right, and they're busy, you know, they're busy doing the work. So no, that would not be a new issue.
Okay.
For me.
So then there's technology. Mm-hmm. Tell me about technology. How does Weston handle tech education?
Well, incoming freshmen have take a digital literacy course, right, about how to use technology and how it can support you in your subject areas. We have Google Classroom in the secondary, and a lot of the elementary schools use Seesaw,
okay,
which is an educational platform where kids can work independently, work in small groups, and communicate with the teacher, right, or in blogs. At the high school, we have a bring your own technology.
All right, what does that mean?
Bring your own device. So kids, whatever you use at home, that's what you're comfortable with, that's what you use at the high school.
So, you know, not everybody has the same iPad. Other people, you would maybe have a Kindle or something like that?
Mm-hmm.
I don't, okay.
A lot of MacBook Airs, that's the one of choice.
Okay. All right,
we make some recommendations of Chromebooks at the middle school. I don't know what they use at elementary, but I know that the teachers there with the kids use Seesaw, which I actually saw in action, where you had second and third graders, you know, teaching each other and correcting work, and they could see themselves doing it, you know, and with comments from the teacher. And I thought that was fabulous.
I am absolutely thunderstruck when I think about the things that kids have. Mm-hmm. We don't need to go there, but the nuns, mm-hmm, when I was in first grade, mm-hmm, didn't even have mimeograph machines.
Sure.
But I'm an old person, you know that.
Well, so I think Weston is pretty good. If it's going to help further the learning, you know,
yeah,
then it's worth investigating the
and
technology.
And what about bringing parents? There are a lot of engineering parents, or people who have technology backgrounds, not, mm-hmm, just engineering, but biotech and pharma, and mm-hmm, lots of parent expertise.
Yes, and some of our councils, like our math council and our science council in particular, you know, which includes people, you know, in tech, you know, that we've leveraged those relationships with campuses, with companies,
mm-hmm,
right? Taking kids on field trips, brought speakers in, and also where the expertise can come in is through every senior at the high school has an internship, and parents are instrumental in helping identify areas in those industries that you've mentioned.
So how does that internship work?
In mid-May, seniors, we have somebody who works with them, a senior internship coordinator, and they work in Weston, they work downtown Boston, they work in other surrounding communities.
Yeah.
Something they're interested in, and maybe a teacher gave them an idea for an internship, or what their parents do for work.
Yeah.
In their context. And they bring that to the school, and the counselor, then the coordinator, then reaches out to them to say, "Would you take our student?" And then the senior teachers, because the seniors are gone, they help support by checking in on them, you know, what they're doing. So if you have, you still have academic work to do, you have to finish that, and then you can begin your internship.
Fabulous.
So there's a.
So I'm going to just interrupt for 1 minute and say we don't have any idea where we are in time. The timer has gone dark. Ah, so we still have an hour left? Oh, we've got all the time in the world. We're going to have a good conversation. Thank you for clicking that for us. I was afraid we were down to 2 minutes and I was going to have to... So anyway, moving from technology to climate change, there is a very active Mothers Out Front group in Bedford, and we're a net zero community, and the school construction, the projects now are implementing technology and in their heating and air conditioning and so forth. Where does climate change fit in your perspective?
Well, you know, a parent at a school committee meeting a few weeks ago talked about issues like climate change. I forget what we were talking about. So we need to do a better job of talking about it, and we do. You know, it's been an intellectual thing that I've I have not engaged in it in a real way in the schools, and I don't believe the district has either. But in the last few months, it's been coming into our consciousness primarily by students. By students. And I'll give you an example. We have a student who came to me with a proposal about, you know, beefless Mondays and how the manufacture of beef, how it impacts the climate, and she gave a whole presentation that was actually pretty outstanding. And we got our food service manager, our kitchen manager, and the director of food services, and our nutritionist. And she brought us all together and made this presentation.
A student?
Yes, yes, she's a senior.
Okay.
Jackie Lou, she's wonderful. She's wonderful. And, you know, she's just an example of somebody who's making connections to climate change with our practices, what we do here in the district. And so, so the mother's group, that's something you'll have to get me up to speed on if I would be fortunate to come proactive.
And they will be delighted to be working with you.
Okay, and how we could be more purposeful in every at every level in our practices and our instruction about how to incorporate climate change. All right, and so that is sort of a blind spot for me.
Okay. Thank you for acknowledging that.
Yes, yes.
Because I think it is a real issue, not a real issue, but there is a very passionate group of parents and residents who are on a very strong climate change track. Mm-hmm. And I don't think we'd have gotten net zero through the schools through the town if it hadn't. So talking a little bit about process, one of the tricky, hard questions is Alice. Mm-hmm. Alice is one of the most, Alice is one of the protocols for dealing with a strong disturbance in the school. And mm-hmm. I'm guessing you may have a better description of it than that.
Well, it's for, an intruder in the school, an active shooter in the schools. And we, you know, I support Alice. I support Alice training, all right? And we did one a few months ago, and we'll probably have a second one before the end of the school year. It's the times that we're in. You know, it's scary for parents and for some kids, but if we had a situation where, God forbid, we had an active shooter or some negative disturbance in the building, we need to have a protocol. We need to know what to do.
Okay. And you've looked at the research that is kind of ambivalent about it or even sometimes negative?
Some of it, you know, but we have a district safety team which brings in leadership from all five buildings, all right, and includes the police and fire. You know, frankly, I think that's good enough for me. People who do this for a living say, you know what, we think this is sound and we want to try it to do it. And we're collaborating, all right? And so now we're working on a reunification. If we have to leave the building and people scatter, okay, where do we unify? Mm-hmm. And we've had to do that once. We had a bomb scare.
A real one or an act?
It was real enough.
Okay.
And they identified a time and a location. And the specificity was such that we felt we had to take it seriously, all right, and evacuate. But people say that, you know, it's not good for kids. And my response is, an armed intruder in a building is not good for kids, right? All right, and, you know, shouldn't we give them some tools to work with? You know, we do the best we can, you know, and the kids with, you know, different disabilities, learning issues, and we try to protect them as much as we can, okay? But in a real crisis, you know, you need to know what to do.
Got to have something in your pocket.
Yes, and it's up. I think we schools are beholden to provide some form of training. Everybody's not going to like everything, okay? Okay, that's one of those issues where you're not going to get unanimity. Somebody's going to disagree. Nonetheless, we need to provide that training.
Another unexpected catastrophic event is going on for all of us these days with COVID-19.
Yes.
The question is, how would you plan for future unexpected catastrophic events if school needs to be suspended for any length of time? You're living that right now.
We are living that right now. Teachers in Weston K through 12, and I believe Bedford's doing something similar tomorrow. We're looking at our online platform, and we're creating, it's called Weston Schools from Home, right? It's a new platform. And it's going to be age appropriate, so teams of teachers from secondary and elementary are looking at ways to present curriculum, okay, for an extended period of time. Because right now our online platforms, our Google Classroom, Seesaw, they support in-school work, all right? So the question is, what do we need to be able to deliver curriculum, okay, long-term? All right, and so some of the key questions are, what are the parameters? What are the expectations of teachers? What are the expectations of students?
And what are the expectations of parents? How do you...
Well, the expectations of parents, I think if you're in secondary, if you're in elementary, it's different, okay? It's different. You know, it's complicated, but I think we're going to learn how to do this because of COVID-19, all right? Because we're forced to collaborate. We're forced to think differently because we can't do the same things, mm-hmm. okay? Particularly students on IEPs who have learning assistants attached to them, right? All right?
And
right? Okay, there's my teacher, but there's my learning assistant who's usually with me in class, all right? So that's on the table. Counselors, how do you counsel? Do you have office hours? I'm going to be online from this time to that time to support students. All right, to answer questions from parents and kids.
And then all the technology behind that.
And technology in COVID-19, the technology specialists, technology experts in our buildings, they're going to be front and center to support curriculum development and curriculum delivery. So they're going to play a huge role, are playing a huge role, okay? Because you might have to develop new platforms, obtain new software, new licenses perhaps, all right, to be able to make this work for an extended period of time. And so this is the beginning because we haven't been here before.
Right? And then that also has budget implications. If mm-hmm. you have to plan for something, whenever technology comes into a conversation at that level, mm-hmm. you're talking a not insignificant money crunch.
Right.
Typically, there may be somebody out there who can do it free or...
Well, no, you're absolutely right. And so we may have to re-examine some priorities. We may have to rethink some things.
Yeah.
You know, because here we are. All right, right now, this is the test case. Okay, it's not going to be perfect, but I think what we're doing now and what districts are going to have to do, developing a process for online delivery, it's a system that can be perfected over time.
Is anybody or has any school department or corporation piloted or worked in online school delivery or curriculum delivery?
Colleges, you know, colleges and universities. I mean, we have a lot of colleges in our Metro West area that are transitioning to online education. So there's models out there.
Okay.
You know, Harvard, MIT, BU, Northeastern, you know, and so there are things that we can adopt. All right, and then particularly in secondary, a lot of schools we have online resources, we just have to use them differently, okay? And in some cases, it's a refining of what we're already doing.
Innovation. Okay.
You know, in every crisis, there's an opportunity.
Crisis right? written on a dangerous wind, isn't that the Chinese
yes.
character?
Yes, and I think this is one of those opportunities because what we're talking about in Weston and what I can't imagine Bedford is not talking about, that this is, again, this is a test case that we can use for other scenarios, okay? What if we have a blizzard and there's 12 feet of snow, all right? This is what we're doing now could work in different scenarios. So COVID-19 and the work that's being done to deliver instruction in case of an extended absence. That could be a gift that keeps on giving, all right? Because it could fit other scenarios as well. So we're building that infrastructure now.
So. Process. Mm-hmm. Process. Seamless communications from the superintendent's office to the building administration, to the teachers, to the parents, to the kids.
Mm-hmm. All necessary things.
And how does that work? Do you have a favorite strategy for getting people on everybody on the same page?
Well, calling them together and meeting with them, you know, so we can I believe in face-to-face communication.
Okay.
That's my first, second, and third. You know, all the other mechanisms that we use to communicate, but gathering people together, and getting feedback. Okay, to discuss priorities or needs or concerns, I believe that is the best way. You know, gathering people together, all right, and to communicate what your priorities are, why they are priorities, and getting the buy-in from them, and communicating with all the relevant stakeholders, given what the issue is. Is
so
that clear? That makes sense.
Yeah, it does.
Okay, I want to make sure I get at your question. So you're asking, how do I communicate?
Well, how what kinds of strategies might you use to be sure that various different levels in that chain are all feeling part of the chain and heard and that information flows?
Well, getting the information to them that I want them to weigh in on.
Okay.
All right, and getting their feedback. Okay, and again, okay, I think what I said first, getting everybody at the table so everybody has a chance to have their say.
But what happens when you can't get everybody to the table? What happens if you have parents who are crazy busy working two jobs, a nanny for the kids, teachers that are stressed beyond?
Okay, well, we post things on our website.
Okay.
Each building has a website, the district website, or if I have a principal's coffee, it's videotape, Western Cable.
Okay.
And so it goes on TV, for instance, we reintroduce school resource offices in each of the buildings, all right? And so my PTO said, wouldn't it be nice to get to know the officer who's a former teacher? And,
okay.
And so we had a principal's coffee. And do you know, we had about 25 people show up, you know, because it was, you know, they wanted to know how it worked, what's the relationship with the town, who's paying for it, and it was filmed, all right? And so people can see what we're doing on cable. They can go to our website, all right? And there's a district blog as well.
There are ways, lots of different methods
lots of different
for pulling
ways.
People together.
And at the high school, we use a tool called Infinite Campus, where I can reach every family and every student, all right, to deliver messages or notices.
And that's an online resource?
Yes. Okay, is this what we use for student communications, for parents and families, and the students themselves? I can hit every grade, okay, and every family. Okay.
Sounds like a great resource. Now I am going to have to read this one. It
okay.
is longer than I couldn't remember it from the start to the finish. A school district is a complex system in itself, and it also functions, or sometimes doesn't, within a number of other complex systems, such as local and larger communities, towns, regions, state, country, world. Please share an example or two of how your analysis and understanding of the often tricky interactions between these various components of a complex system. Think systems, various subsets of systems, parents, ditto subject, you know, subsets of parents, teachers, community and the DESE has helped you to avoid unintended. Oh no, it went on the other page. Hold on a minute. Well, I'm guessing that's going to say unintended consequences. So, and I guess the question coming down to it is how do you pull everybody together and not do something you weren't intending to do in a complex situation?
Ooh, that's a big question.
It is a big question. You're absolutely right. But it's an important one. I mean, I think the whole idea of how we think we're doing right and It doesn't quite get there. What have you, is there anything that you have thought was just a terrific idea that turned out differently for one reason or another?
Not the big ideas that would necessarily impact students, like, you know, curriculum level. I'm sorry, I just have to think about that one a bit.
All right.
That was a big question. Have I ever done anything that didn't quite work out? I'm sure I have.
Well, immediately comes to mind. Sometimes you think you're going one direction, you go another, and it's where you should have been. You just didn't know it at first.
Yeah. Well, I'll give you an example. It's an example that it's not a systems understanding that we live in with different constituencies who have different priorities.
Yeah.
You know, a little thing. I sent out at the beginning of the year, 3 days before the start of school, an issue about parking. Juniors, you can't drive, right? Huge explosion, right? Because I hadn't considered, or my team, we hadn't considered all the nuances of driving for different family members. That went beyond just teenagers wanting to drive, right?
Okay.
And so I had to back up that process, form a committee with parents, with kids, and with teachers to look at the same issue. We got to the same place. We had to limit parking, but I needed to understand how, you know what, it's not that simple. This is why my child needs to drive and how it helps this two-parent household. Okay.
It was a real learning that came out of that.
It was a real learning that came out of that, and it was a situation where I did not communicate soon enough. Okay. You know, it's an administrative decision. Okay, team feels we should do this. Okay, let's do it. And I didn't follow my gut, right? And so I didn't understand the systems, the nuances about a seemingly simple decision, right? A seemingly trivial.
Do you think there is really a trivial decision?
No. No, there are decisions that have lower weight, okay, and there are decisions that have higher weight, but not trivial. And that situation really let me see that, okay? For me, it was about just kids parking in the parking lot, but it was childcare implications, work implications, after school implications, all right, elder care implications, all right.
None of us are standing alone.
None of us are standing alone. And so
none of us is standing
the ripple
alone.
Effect. So I guess that's a very concrete example of thought one thing, had to change course, all right, because I didn't take into account the various wider systems.
Bits and pieces. Music and art.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have them in Weston?
Yes, we do.
Tell me about them.
They're robust, particularly our music program and our art program. We host, I think, two major art shows at the high school, which are district-wide, so because we have the space to do that. We have multiple concerts across the school year, orchestra, chamber music, chorus,
yeah.
Jazz. I think they contribute a lot to students, and that's where a lot of students' passions are.
A point of connection.
It's a point of connection. You have a cohort of people that you are teamed with if you're in the band together, and you really have to rely on each other. And they're institutions in Weston, and I imagine something similar is here in Bedford. In the programs and the theater arts. The arts, I think, are very important, and I am a supporter of the arts.
So this one is another lengthy question, but I do know that I have the end of it here, so we won't be left off in space as we were before.
Mm-hmm.
Maintaining a sense of continuity and learning from past efforts, both successful and relative failures, mm-hmm. seems to be a challenge within many school systems as they confront changing needs and push for change. What have you done in your own practice, or what could you envision doing as superintendent in Bedford, to foster a sense of constructive, not static, continuity, and help all members in the community most effectively learn from each other and others' past and current efforts?
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm assuming it, I think that sounds like it's from a teacher.
That was one of the ones, yes.
From a teacher. And I think professional development is the first thing that comes to mind. Teachers teaching teachers about what they're doing in schools and in their classes. Some of the best feedback that I've ever gotten about professional development was when teachers taught other teachers to share best practices, right? To talk about the students that they have in common, right? Didn't necessarily bring somebody to talk about teaching and learning, okay? What are we doing? Okay, so professional development is what comes to mind, where teachers can talk to each other about what they're seeing in their classes, right? And even yeah. students that they share, okay? Okay. And so that's a good venue. And so my job is to give space and time to make that happen, right? And one of the things, I don't know if you have it here, but one of the things Weston does, and I think does well, is for teachers K through 12 in the summer, they have a series of summer workshops through July and August for teachers to come and work on, you know, district building department initiatives, all right?
At various different levels.
At different levels. They could be interdisciplinary, all right? For instance, the middle and high school, we share teachers, right? Departments are 6 through 12, all right? World languages, music, visual arts and wellness, they're K through 12, all right? So those are times where teachers across buildings
get to know one another.
Get to know one another and work with one another, right? And to develop curriculum, all right? And transition planning from one level to the next.
Oh, that.
Right, and so if Bedford doesn't have that, that's something I think you should look at. And if I were superintendent, I would work with the team to see how can we make this happen. Right.
What have I not asked you? What have Bedford's community and teachers not asked you that you wanted especially to say?
What have I done in terms of equity? You know, for students.
Okay.
Okay, students, bringing in programming. I'm very proud of the fact that I think after 14 years, I think Weston is. More different types of learners have a home there. They can see themselves there. All right.
And see themselves as part of a community?
Yes, yes. And so whether it's the introduction and the creation of our enrichment program, which is our general education academic support, affectionately known as TEC.
Okay,
TEC for short, you know, and so that's about 10 years old now, and we're doing a good business supporting teachers and students, right? Our bridge program, students on IEPs with social and emotional difficulties, all right? A COMPASS program, which is like a transition program if you're outplaced, in offering different types of courses in the curriculum, you know, different types of electives, all right? For different types of learners.
Would the three communities in Bedford, and I'm very speaking very broadly here, the kids who live within Bedford's confines, or within our borders, mm-hmm. the kids who are attached to Hanscom Field, the kids who are perhaps of military families mm-hmm. or are attached to Hanscom, and then the kids from Boston, how do you posit Bedford might be different from Weston? Because you have almost that same, well, you've got two populations.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have the Hanscom kids.
No, we've had some military families over the years. We have our Boston community, and let's stick with Boston for the moment. We have a strong Weston, Metco family, Boston family friends structure, for new families coming into Weston, all right? And they're assigned a host family, you know, so that they can be more a part of the community.
So
we've done simple things like alter bus schedules so that kids could stay late for practices or extracurriculars to participate, all right? And they can get back home, okay, in a safe manner. We have a growing Asian population of various stripes, you know, from all over Asia. And that's where you see growth in our EL program, all right? And so again, providing programming where they can feel that they are learning and being part of the community, all right? What is it that you need to learn? So I would envision, you know, if I were to come here, you know, getting together with all the groups, you know, what do you need to be successful here? Okay, what's missing in your experience? Okay? All right? Surveying them, you know?
Getting that data to stand on.
Getting the data.
Yeah.
All right, let's not guess. What are they saying? What are the parents saying? All right? Okay. Getting folks together. Principals, faculties, let's look at the data. Okay, how can we enhance this experience for this group of kids? Right? What can we do?
So we have in our allotted time, we've been talking for an hour and it doesn't seem quite that right. I mean, it doesn't seem any kind of like an hour. And we have some time left. And one of the best questions came from one of the members of the community. And it is, tell me a story. Please?
A story.
Yeah. Of your choosing.
Oh, boy. Have to give me a few seconds to tell you a story.
I absolutely do. It's
A few years ago, I was sitting at my desk. And a young man walked in my office. I said, Mr. Parker, what do I have to do to get suspended? And so he says, I have to go. What do I have to do? And so I stopped and I said, sit down. Let's chat. And he was sort of a loner. So we went for a walk. In the campus, we have a pond. So we went for a walk, and he just needed to let it out, whatever it was. I just listened. And he started chatting, and he began to tell me about his music. And he took out of his back pocket, he said, he didn't feel like he had a place here at the high school, okay? His passion wasn't what we offered, and he felt alone. And he took out a little black book. Not a little black book, with literally hundreds of poems and songs. And I said, do you realize what kind of a gift you have? What kind of a gift you have?
Yeah.
You know? And his face brightened up. Okay? He just needed somebody to acknowledge, you know? He felt something was valuable, and somebody else said, that's a gift. And I'll never forget, his whole demeanor changed. Okay? Now, it was 2 hours, but you know what? At that moment, he needed those 2 hours because he was feeling lost. And I was just glad I had the wherewithal to, you know, not say, you know what? Can you come back? I'm busy. Right?
That may be part and parcel of what Challenge Success is all about. Having a place for, but I'm not supposed to be making those decisions. You knew that, though.
Well, that's the story that comes to mind, and of course, when I walk out of here, I'm going to think of 100 more that I could have said.
And I hope you're going to give me a call and tell them to me.
So that's a story that comes to mind. I could think of that one, and it will happen. I'll walk out of here, and I'm like, oh my God, there's that one. So it's a story. It's a story about, you know, relationships. He ended up being in my advisory. This young man, he's graduated. He's gone, moved on. And And I think he felt he found somebody he could build a relationship with, because education is relational. So you'll hear me talk a lot about relationships. It's relational. The adults look at their leaders and will gauge their relationship based on, they will base what you can or cannot do with them based on the relationship they perceive they have with you. And it's the same way with kids. Kids will allow you to stretch them, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, based on the relationship they feel they have with you, their teacher, their coach, their counselor, right? It's relational, okay? And whether it's in the classroom, on the stage, in the concert hall, the athletic field.
Or the finance committee.
Or the finance committee, the school committee, right?
Yeah.
The selectmen, right? Superintendents negotiate a series of relationships, right? That's how I like to think of it.
So I don't want to use the word value, but how do you balance the very poignant and rightful and with the crass? If we can just take that out. But there is a certain 2 + 2 = 4. There are algorithms. There are ways that budgets have to be put together, and there mm-hmm. are all those. The once you get past all of the decisions, how do you get to those decisions? Who do you work with? How do you develop a budget?
Well, you work with the people who you need to talk to from the superintendent's level and the director of finance. You know, there's the FinCom committee.
Yeah.
You know, there's the selectmen, you know, and then there are your principals, you know, who submit budgets for consideration to be part of a larger whole, you know. And again, you leverage those relationships where you can have hard conversations or differing opinions about something, but you know you have to come to an outcome. So what's the best way to do that? It's better to do that and make those hard decisions if you have a relationship with the people that you have to negotiate with, all right? To identify the priorities and to make decisions about this is how we as a school, as a district, as a town are going to move forward, what we're going to support, all right? You can do it in a context where you don't have strong relationships or cordial relationships. It's much more difficult, all right? But if you have a relationship and you feel that, you know what, we're going to compromise. We know we're going to have to compromise on some things, okay? But we can have a frank conversation about what our priorities are, okay? And, you know, what the dollar amount is going to be, all right? I have parameters I have to work, and we all do, okay? But within that, how can we leverage that, maximize that to the greatest extent to support our kids and our teachers who support them, right? That's how you do it. It's never easy. And it's one step forward, two step back.
Asymptosis.
Two steps back. Yeah. And so how do you balance? You do the best you can. All right. I don't have a magic formula for how you balance that. Okay, you do what you feel is necessary at the time, and you make sure you talk to the right people, you have the right people at the table, or you get to them, all right? So that there's some sort of a process, all right, where we're transparent in what we want, all right? And I think that's the best you can do, all right? So is it a perfect balance all the time, every time? I don't believe so, all right? Okay. Sometimes given the needs, you know, we need to focus on this and not that, right? Because that means I may have to spend more time with a certain constituency at a given moment than someone else.
What would you like Bedford's last impression of you to be? What would be the final wrap-up thing you'd like to share with Bedford on Bedford Television and the teachers and the students and the parents and the community?
I believe Bedford is a place that I can contribute from what I've learned over the last 25 more years in education, as a teacher, as a union official, as a principal, as a parent. Okay, a former Metco student, and you know, kids have gone K through 12. And I believe Bedford is a place where I could learn and grow. Right? That you have things you could teach me as I develop as a leader. Right? And I think we could do some great things together. And I would love the opportunity to do that.
That may be as good as it gets or needs to get.
All right.
Anthony, thank you very much.
Well,
we didn't
you.
Quite go to the end of our time, but the other side of that is, what do they say? Brevity is the soul of wit. Thank you for being with us. This is Anthony Parker. He is the principal of Weston High School, and he is in the running for superintendent of Bedford Schools. And there will be more of these conversations for you to evaluate. And when you watch them on YouTube, there will be a form, a feedback form, so that you'll be able to share your thoughts, since we can't all be in the same room at the same time. So, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Delightful to meet you. And I'd shake your hands, but this is COVID-19.
Yes.
So, thank you, Bedford. We'll see you the next time.